for that fear that took our breath away. Faith so weak that we could barely pray. But he heard every word, every whisper. Now those altars in the wilderness tell the story of his faithfulness. Never once did he fail, and he never will.
Come on, church, let me hear you.
This is our God. This is who he is. He loves us. This is our God. This is what he does. He saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus. Who pulled me out of that pit? He did. He did. Nobody but Jesus. Who pulled me out of that pit? He did, he did. Who paid for all of our sins? Nobody but Jesus. Who rescued me from that grave? Yahweh, Yahweh. Who gives the glory and praise? Nobody but Jesus. Who rescued me from that grave? Yahweh, Yahweh, who gives the glory and praise? Nobody but him. This is our God. This is who he is. He loves us. This is our God. This is what he does. He saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus.
His goodness lost in his
How can I be lost when you have called me found?
chase me down, you seek me out. How can I be lost when you have called me found?
Hey!
Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is near, like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. Your love is fierce. Your love is fierce. Your love is fierce. His love is fierce.
There's something about walking into a place where you don't know anybody that is scary. You don't know them. They don't know you. And it's just kind of a ground zero experience where you have to kind of just work your way into becoming acquainted. Those are difficult times. Would you agree? Those are difficult times. And somebody the other day was saying, some of us were talking about ministry and talking about church, and someone said, there's nothing quite so scary as walking into a church as a visitor for the first time. Amen? And I pray that we will always be that place where whoever comes in, whether it's their first time or their thousandth time or beyond, that this will be a place where people feel a spirit of belonging, a spirit of inclusiveness, where they feel like they are wanted, and in time that they will know that they are known and loved and appreciated. It's a very important ingredient to having a well established life, if you will, a sense of security about who you are. I know that whenever I go home to visit with Dad and I'm meeting someone that has become a part of his life, whenever he says, this is my oldest son, Ronnie, he still calls me Ronnie most of the time, who's come up for a visit, just that kind of an introduction, this is my son. And I want you to meet him in this moment. There's something about that brings security and brings a sense of belonging to our lives that is very important. Well, John was writing a letter to the believers of his time. And in the third chapter of 1 John, he makes this statement. He says, see what great love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called the children of God. What an incredible thing that God, through His Son Jesus, has made a way for us to come into His forever family and to have that knowledge that we belong to Him and that sense of belonging that establishes us. It means everything when it comes to having a life that is well-positioned, that has a sense of security and foundation. Max Lucado, I was reading something that he wrote the other day about this subject, and he said, when parents send their kids to summer camp, they have to sign certain documents. You've done that, right? And one of the documents asks, who is the responsible party? If Johnny breaks his arm or Susie breaks out with measles, who will be responsible? And then he says in his writings, hopefully, Mom and Dad will sign their names on the dotted line. And how many times have we signed the dotted line that this child belongs to me, and if something happens, I am the responsible party, and you have permission to treat them if they meet with illness or injury? And Max Lucado uses that example to say God has signed His name to the document of who's responsible for us ultimately and eternally. And that means something, to know that God has taken responsibility for us, The Bible says that he guarantees our safe arrival into heaven, that heavenly port that he has prepared for us. And he's with us now at the same time. Not only is he waiting for us in that eternal moment, but he is with us from day to day, from situation to situation in the current moment. We belong to God. That means something. Amen? We belong to him, and he has promised that he will be with us and that he'll take care of us, whatever the circumstance is in our lives. And the Bible uses a number of metaphors to describe this belonging relationship that has become a part of our spiritual union and journey with our Heavenly Father. For one, in John 10, God says through his servant, through his son, Jesus, that we are his sheep and that Jesus is our shepherd. And he says, I know my sheep and my sheep know me. And it means something for us this morning that God knows who we are. And moreover, he knows exactly what we need and what's going on at any given moment in our lives. The question is, are we allowing ourselves the opportunity to know him? He knows us. But can you say this morning that I know him? I hear him. I hear as he speaks to me. I hear him as I read his word and he makes known in my experience the eternal truths that are written there. I was sharing in Sunday school this morning and shared this last Wednesday morning in Luke 1, beginning a journey through that gospel account. And in Luke 1, Luke says in the very beginning, he writes to a man by the name of Theophilus. What a name. Theos in the Greek means God. The ending of that name, Theophilus, that P ending of that word points to phileo, love. The guy's name was Lover of God. Is there a better name than that? Lover of God. And Luke says, I'm writing to you so that you might know that the things you have heard about Jesus, that they are the truth. And I've written it down in an orderly fashion so that you might be able to commit yourself to this Jesus and what he has come to establish for each and every one of us. And this morning, God wants us to know that he knows us individually and he knows us intimately and that he is able to minister to us and connect with us in ways that go beyond what anybody else can do. But the question is, am I taking the time to think about that, to devote myself to knowing him in such a way that the portals might be swung open, that I might receive the grace and the glory that he is wanting to bring to my life in this particular moment. We're his sheep. We belong to him. We are a part of the flock that he has redeemed for himself. And so this morning, just to know that God cares about what's happening in each and every one of our lives and that he is walking with us every step of the way, that means something. Now, I know that I've used these months of Becky's illness and recovery so many times, but it's where I've been living. And let me just say to you that when somebody would come in to be involved in Becky's treatment, when they would come in and they would begin to talk about things that helped us to know that they had read her medical chart, it brought security to us. We felt like, okay, this person has taken the time to know that she is here because of the original diagnosis being acute necrotizing pancreatitis. And when they used those words, we knew that they had read her chart. We knew that they had taken time to familiarize themselves with what has been going on over the course of the weeks, and then it turned into months. And then they would address the current concern, and it gave us confidence. We felt like, okay, they have put this in the context of what's been going on in her life for this time period. But then occasionally someone would walk in, and they would say, okay, this is what's going on. Your blood work says this. And why were you originally brought in? Huh? Why are you here in the hospital now? I didn't because I'm just a nice preacher. And if I told them off there that day in the hospital room, next week they might be watching me on YouTube. But honestly, there were times when I wanted to say, hey, you can go. You can go. If you haven't taken the time to know why we're here, to know why she just had this major surgical event in her life, if you haven't taken the time to familiarize yourself beyond this morning's blood work, then we would like to have someone else. And what I'm saying to you is that our God is completely familiar. He's God. He's completely familiar with everything that's going on in our lives. But if you and I are going to live in the fullness of what that means, then we've got to take time to think about Him. God said to Joshua, who had been given leadership over the nation of Israel after the death of Moses, and Joshua was shaking in his boots. Read the book of Joshua. And in the very opening chapter, God says to him, I think it's in verse 8, Joshua 1:8, be strong and of a good courage. And he said it to him three times. Be strong and of a good courage. Be strong and of a good courage. And then he made that strength and courage a real possibility when he said, for I am with you. Here's the thing. God can be for us and God can be with us, but if I am not taking the opportunity to be aware of that promise and of that truth, then I am floating around in the midst of the trauma that is happening at any given moment without any sense of belonging or security. That's why I say it's so important that we know, that we understand, that we meditate on the reality that there is a God who knows you, and a God who loves you, and a God who is for you, a God who can do the miraculous in your behalf, a God who can go beyond anything that you ever thought possible. There is a God like that who is involved in our lives, and He wants us to know that about Him. And so John, in writing to his audience of that day, said, what great love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called the children of God. And then he went on to say, and that is what we are. We're not just called the children of God. We are the children of God. And he cares about what's happening in our lives. It makes a difference when we know that. It makes a difference when we meditate on that. And so God said to Joshua, be strong and of a good courage, for I am with you. And then he said, meditate on the law day and night. The Lord was saying to Joshua, keep your eyes on me. There are going to be things that happen that will be disconcerting. There will be things that will be traumatic in your experience. Keep your eyes on me. Don't be afraid. Be courageous. Keep moving forward. I'm with you. I'm with you. I'm with you. If you go the rest of this week and you don't open your Bible till next Sunday, you are cheating yourself of the security and the sense of belonging that God wants you to experience in the throes of life. Begin every day with His Word. End every day with His Word. Pray all between. Yeah. He knows you. And He wants you to know Him. And He will make Himself known. But make no mistake about it, as Paul wrote to Timothy, God says to us, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. There's work involved in keeping your focus in allowing God to bring His love and His security to your life. What's happening in your life right now that is leaving you feeling like you're being tossed to and fro? What is going on? Turn your eyes upon Jesus. He knows you by name. He's calling your name. Are you listening? And then the Bible uses another metaphor. The church is being prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Not only are you loved, but in God's sight, you are glorious. You are precious to Him. He has chosen you for himself. This church that is adorned as his bride, it is the collection of people who through the ages of time have placed their faith in God, the one true God. For us in this gospel dispensation in which we exist, the church is made up of those who have placed their faith in Jesus, the Lamb of God, who went to the cross for our salvation. The church is made up of those who are redeemed because they have made Jesus their Savior. We are His bride. We are glorious in His sight. We are chosen because He simply loves us and wants to be with us, not only in time, but in eternity. Lord, help us to know what it means to be the bride of Christ. I remember being at the funeral home for family visitation on the occasion of my mom's passing. And my dad was standing up near the casket where mom laid. Nobody else was there, standing close to him. People were starting to come into the room. And I slipped up behind dad just to kind of be there with him as we were all gathering in at the very beginning of the visitation period. And I heard him whisper words of affection to my mom. And it blessed my soul. The love that he was expressing in that moment, the soul that he was investing in this lady who had been his bride for 62 years at that time. And it touched me. It means something when God says the church, people who have chosen to be in relationship with Him, it means something when the Bible says that we are His bride. He is making us more glorious than we already are for that eternity that He has prepared for us. He loves you. He's devoted to you. In sickness and in health, for richer, for poorer, He loves you. Galatians 4:7 says, "You are no longer a slave, but God's own child." And if you read the book of Galatians, you find out that Paul is writing to a group of people who had come to faith in Christ, but because of influences around them, were falling back into a legalistic religion instead of a heartfelt relationship. And Paul is challenging them. He's saying to them, even if an angel were to come and to deliver to you another gospel other than the gospel that has been delivered concerning the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, even if an angel delivered another gospel, it is not valid. Why in the world are you falling back into legalistic works? Why in the world are you reverting to the law and the legalism that is attached to the law? You have been saved. Because of the righteousness of Christ, you have been saved through faith. Why would you fall back into that? And so in that context, he is saying, you're no longer slaves to the law, but you're God's own child. And since you are His child, God has made you His heir as well. Which is to say, not only is God related to you in this moment, and not only does he take you into his care in this very given hour, but as you look toward the future, you will join in all of the riches that are a part of his kingdom, because he has made you an heir of everything that belongs to him. You belong to God, you're his child, and you will have everything you need, and you have a future because he has made you his own. Again, there's just something about belonging to a family that means something. There's something about being with your people that brings a sense of balance and justice to your life. There's just something about being with your people, am I right? That just brings something out in you, and that's the way it's meant to be. And you see, as far as families go, this is a family. Because the blood of Jesus flows through our veins, spiritually speaking. And so we're brothers and sisters in the family of God because of what Jesus has done for us. Not only are we a child who belongs to God, but because we are children who belong to God, we belong to one another. You've proven that over and over again that you get that. And it means something to all of us. Because when life is happening and your church family shows up, wow, it's amazing what that does in us and what it does for us. Months of hospitalization, people just keep coming, keep coming. I can't tell you. And Becky and I'll be talking and somebody will come up in conversation. I said, oh yeah, they were there when you were at Richland. Were they? She doesn't remember any of it. Were they? It means something. I'm standing in the funeral home for my mom's visitation, and people come walking in from the church. And I almost fell out. I mean, that's 300 miles one way to come and say, hey, we know you. We care about you. We're here for you. And then the rainy Sunday of her funeral, some more people come walking in from this church family. And it brought such strength and such security in a very insecure moment in our lives. God wants us to know about this reality, and he wants us to live in this reality, and he wants us to understand what it means that his presence can bring peace to us even when life is so very stormy. So 1 John 3, listen to these first three verses. See what great love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known, but we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Be aware of this truth. Be secure in this truth. Be joyful in this truth. There's much we don't know, but we know we belong to God. And if we belong to God, no matter what, he has signed the form. I am responsible for this individual. Years ago, I was walking by the medical building that is positioned there beside of Toomey Hospital. And it's got all that reflective glass. And I'm walking down the sidewalk on my way to the hospital to visit someone, and I know my image is in that glass. And I'm just wondering, how do I look today? And then the thought strikes me, I can't see inside, but they can see outside. So if I'm going to look, I need to steal a glance real quickly so they won't be like, look at this guy. He really likes himself. So I just real quickly look over. And when I look over, I didn't see me. I saw my dad. And I'll be honest, in that moment, I thought, when did that happen? I used to look more like Tommy, and now I look more like my dad. When did that happen? Well, one day, Tommy and I, not too many years ago, are right together. We're riding somewhere, probably going somewhere to get something to eat to take back to the house. And we're just talking about all kinds of stuff. And I said to him, in the context of that conversation, however it was unfolding, I said, well, look at me and look at Grandpa Bauer. That's where you're going. Dad, you really think so? I said, that's where you're going. Because I remember when we first moved into the parsonage, there was a picture of my dad when he was a new recruit in the U.S. Army back in what he called the Brown Shoe Army. And they wore those little Eisenhower jackets back in those early days. And so my dad is sitting for a portrait in his Army uniform. And y'all, I'm telling you, he was like 20 years old. And Tommy, at 20 years old, you would have thought that was him in the picture. As a matter of fact, one day somebody walked through the parsonage and said, what's Tommy doing in an Army uniform? I mean, Tommy, that's where you're going. You look like him then, you're going to look like him later. And the older Tommy gets, the more he looks like my dad, the more he looks like me. What I'm saying to you is, it does not yet appear what you're going to look like when you get to heaven. But this scripture says, you will be like Jesus. You will be like Jesus. The scripture says, all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to His purpose. The very next verse says, that we might be conformed to the likeness of His Son, Jesus. All of the things that He is working together for our good because He loves us is that we might become more and more and more and more like Jesus. Do you look like Jesus? What would need to happen for you to look more like Jesus? God is working. Will you join Him? Will you join Him in what He is working out in you? Or will you resist Him and go your own way? Yeah, there's something about belonging that just kind of stabilizes life for us. The only thing that's certain about life is it's uncertain. Beloved, you are the children of God. Let that sink in. He knows you. He cherishes you. Let that sink in. Let's pray. And let me just give you a moment. Pray about whatever is on your heart right now. You belong to God. He is glad to hear you in this moment. Talk to Him for a moment, and then I'll pray. Lord, as I preach this message this morning that you put in my heart, I'm just thinking about the fact that even this morning as I've walked into this place of worship, that I've interacted with a lot of different people, and there have been numerous ones, and as we were closing our interaction, that just said it out loud, I love you. Wow. That's why I love coming here, Lord. For over 35 years now, I have looked forward to gathering in this place because of the sense of belonging that is associated with being here. No matter what else is going on in my life, it's like when I come here, these people who belong to you, I belong to them while I belong to you. And you express to me over and over again that my life means something, that my family means something to you and to these people. Oh, Lord, thank you. Thank you that no matter what's going on in the world and around us, that there is that sense of love and belonging that anchors us over and over and over again. I thank you, Lord, that I've been blessed to have parents and siblings and extended family who have loved me no matter what. And then I thank you for a wife of 50 years and the children and grandchildren that have come to us, that they have loved me no matter what. And then to have a church family like we had in Columbia and like we have here who have loved me no matter what. Thank you. Now help me to love like I've been loved, because someone needs to know they belong, that they're not forgotten, they're not forsaken, they belong. Let your Spirit press these truths into our souls, not only today, but the days to come. Because, Lord, sometimes life is tough. And the only thing that gets us through is to know we're loved. If anybody wants to pray about anything, these altars are always available. And if you want to pray about something at the altar, now's a good time to just make that move, even before we start singing. Could be that your moving up here will bring someone to pray with you that was meant to share with you in this moment. The Bible says that we are to bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. In other words, we need to love on each other. We need to help each other. We need to carry one another. So if you want to pray about anything, come on. You belong. We love you. We care about what's happening in your life.
The Father.
leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar.
Altar.